Let's look at the properties for a sampling distribution of proportions. What we'll need to start these is some population proportion. They'll have to tell you some historical value or what we expect to come through as some proportion. Then what we want to do is see how does p hat behave. So sampling distribution model for a proportion, we're trying to evaluate what happens when we take a sample. And what we talked about in the simulation video is that we should be getting this bell-shaped curve out. In order to get that bell-shaped curve out, we have to pass these three conditions. We need to have independence, we need to have randomization, and then we're gonna have this success-failure condition, which checks our sample size. And that's where you wanna make sure you have at least 10 successes, at least 10 failures as well. And you have to have both. If one fails, then your sample size isn't large enough. So we want this bell-shaped curve out, and what we saw in the previous video is that where it centers when we take these sample proportions is we should be seeing our population proportion coming through. So that's why here, if we look at this average of sample proportions, it's going to be equal to our population proportion, what we expect to be coming through. So that's going to define the center of our distribution. So we're going to have a bell-shaped curve if we pass those conditions, and at the center of that curve, our population proportion. Then for standard deviation, to have our standard deviation of sample proportions, take all those p hat values, calculate a standard deviation, and how we can find that is taking the square root of p times q over n. And again, q is just 1 minus p. It's representing the probability of failure. So for standard deviation, we'll have a little calculation to do with that. So that'll set up our curve, and then from there we can start calculating probabilities. So let's try an example here. So suppose 60% of college students are either very satisfied or completely satisfied with their online shopping experience. We decide to take a nationwide random sample of 2,500 college students and ask if they agree. Is it reasonable to use a normal model here? So the information they give us, here's that proportion that we need. So they have the 60% that they expect. We're taking a sample size of 2,500. And what we need to see is, do we pass the conditions? So we need to make sure we have independence, randomization, and we need to make sure we pass that success-failure condition. So for independence, it's about, are the results influencing each other? Typically randomization, random samples, and independence typically go together, because if you're very random, there's not going to be much reliance on the individual values. So independence, yes, their responses are going to be independent of each other. Randomization, here we can actually check it out because it says the word random there, so we definitely know we have randomization. And then for the success failure condition, what we want to do is take 2,500 times our probability of success, that 0.6, and take 2,500 times, and then we want 1 minus that value. So p and q should always add up to 1 there. Let's see, this is going to be 1,500. And this will be 1,000. Both are larger than or equal to 10. So we're good there. So in terms of showing works with these, independence, randomization, kind of assume, but show your work for success failure, because it's basically proof that we can move forward, proof that we have a bell-shaped curve. So once we pass those three conditions, I know my distribution is gonna be bell-shaped. So find the mean and standard deviation. So the mean for our proportions and standard deviation for our proportions. Mean for the proportions, you're just copying. So we just need to find our population proportion, which was that 0.6. That's that. Standard deviation, we need to do a little calculation. You're going to take a square root, 0.6 times 0.4 over 2,500. And just make sure all of that's underneath a square root when you throw it into your calculator, and that should be a 0.0098. So our distribution, if we're looking for this proportion of 2,500 students that are either very satisfied or completely satisfied with their online shopping experience, we expect it to be 60% of those 2,500 students, but on average that's going to deviate by a 0.0098. So 0.98% is how it will deviate. So this creates a distribution of proportions, showing this proportion we expect, and then how far above and below we can expect to go. So what's the probability that the sample proportion who agree is at least 57%? And this is the sample proportion we could throw in there of the 2,500. So that we're taking those 2,500 people. If we take that sample, what's the probability of seeing at least 57% coming through? So our distribution is that we expect 60% to come through, and we want to see if we talk to these 2,500 people, what's the probability of being 0.57 or lower. So we'll use our distribution there. So we're going to go to GeoGebra. We're going to set our mean to 0.6, set our standard deviation to 0.0098, and then we want to look below, so we're going to go to the left, and then we're going to have 0.57. And that's going to be a 0.001. Oh, I made the classic mistake of going in the wrong direction. That's good. Everyone makes mistakes. I'm going to keep it in the video. At least is to the left. Silly Julia. All right. So we'll still have that cutoff value of 0.57. If this had said who agree is less than 57%, then that would have been perfect. But this should be at least. So we want to go to the other side. This is going to be the probability of being more than or equal to 0.57. So we just need to switch our direction here to the right. And so 0.9989. Gotta be careful of the wording. All right, so what this tells us in the wording of these sentences can be a little tricky because you're gonna be dealing with two percentages here. You're dealing with a percent probability, and that's what's gonna be coming from GeoGebra, but then you're also dealing with a percentage that's a cutoff value. But what you wanna keep in mind is that that is representing a sample proportion, whereas the area under the curve is representing a probability. So you just want to be sure you organize these two percentages that we're going to talk about. So let's say with a sample size of 25 students, or just with a sample of 2,500 students, we want to talk about who our sample is. There is, if I talk about my percent chance, I want to use this probability that's coming from GeoGebra. So there is a 99.89% chance that at least 57% of those students agree. So we're talking about this percent chance of looking at a sample and seeing a percentage with a certain outcome. So we're working with proportions, it's categorical data again. So it's like the survey that we gave them was yes or no answers, and we want this proportion that agree. And attached to that is this probability that's coming from GeoGebra. So we just want to be careful to organize this. But this is our process for a sampling distribution of proportions. You want to check those conditions, because then you have a bell-shaped curve, and then you just need to adjust your standard deviation. But we're getting this distribution, and your number line for these, when you make your number line, this number line is of proportions. So those values are always going to be between 0 and 1, because they're representing a percentage of a group, a percentage of your sample. So we'll look at some more examples in the next video.